He wheeled and ducked as a bowstring twanged. Something like a white flash of light streaked through the bushes. Balthus knew it was an arrow. Then, with a tigerish bound, Conan was through the bushes, and Balthus caught the gleam of steel as he whirled his sword and heard a death scream. The next instant he had broken through the bushes after the Cimmerian. A Pict with a shattered skull lay face down on the ground, his fingers spasmodically clawing at the grass. Half a dozen others were swarming about Conan, swords and axes lifted. They had cast down their bows, useless at such close quarters. Their lower jaws were painted white, contrasting vividly with their dark faces. And designs on their muscular breasts differed from any Balthus had ever seen. One of them hurled his axe at Balthus and rushed after it with a lifted knife. Balthus ducked and then caught the wrist that drove the knife licking at his throat. They went to the ground together, rolling over and over. The Pict was like a wild beast, his muscles hard as steel strings. Today, on Starships and Steel, we're talking about combat. Stay tuned! Today on Starships and Steel, we're continuing our look at the 2D20 Conan RPG. This is our third installment of this. We are looking at combat today, the most exciting part, some people would say, of role-playing games. Probably after this episode, we'll do an episode 4, which will be an example of play, and then maybe down the road, I'll do another episode on magic, but that'll probably be further down the road. So, episode 3 of this series, we're going to be drinking Sasquatch Stout. It's one I haven't tried before. It says this was voted best beer in Canada in 2014. The Sasquatch Stout is smooth with notes of mocha, coffee, and roasted barley. It says match our Sasquatch with steak, oysters, or even chocolate cake. I'm going to match it with nothing. I'm going to drink it by itself. The name Sasquatch sends shivers down even the most grizzled man's spine. Today, the Sasquatch has retreated into folklore, dark and robust, both. Sasquatches are known to be found lurking around the crackling fire. The only difference is with our stout, you will have the opportunity to experience it more than once. This was made in Chilliwack, part of Canada. OldYaleBrewingCompany.com, 5% alcohol. Kind of the old series, this is the Tall Tale series. So let's crack this open, see how she tastes. All right, I'm gonna use a Guinness glass today. This isn't Guinness, but at least it's stout. It's close enough. Nice and dark looking. And we'll head on that boy. That's good. All right. I'm gonna have to wait for the head to go away this time before I have a sample there. Smells all right. Pretty good taste. It's not as smooth as you might find from Guinness in a can, but that's to be expected, as this has no widget in it. The color is supposed to be pitch black, it says. Let's hold that up to the light and take a look. It's really less light through than Guinness does, I'll give it that. Guinness not actually being black, but we'll talk about that later. We're here to talk about Conan, not beer. Maybe a little bit of bow beer. So, combat. The combat system in this game is pretty fast-paced. A lot of things can die quickly. You can die quickly too if you're a player, although it's less likely. Combat works pretty similar to how we did skill tests in the last one. Basic test is difficulty 1, based against your agility or melee skill. And everything works from there. So we're just going to go right into the stats that weapons have. Weapons have a few basic stats. They have something called grip, which is like one-handed, two-handed, unbalanced. That kind of idea, so who can use it. Unbalanced is a special one if you need to be over a certain strength, which I don't know off the top of my head, to use it with a single hand. So there's swords in Conan that are unbalanced, they're big and heavy, and if you're strong enough, you can use it one-handed. So if you think of the 82 film, Conan's sword's pretty big. If you weren't as strong and burly as him, you might have to use two hands to swing that. But because he's so big and strong, he can just use that one hand and just chop guys with it. They have a reach, which basically has nothing to do with range, but it has to do with how weapons interact with each other. So spears versus swords, swords versus daggers, that kind of thing. They get advantages depending on how the combat goes. We'll go over that in an example later in the video. They have damage. Damage uses combat dice, which I talked about very briefly in the first video. So combat dice are basically D6s, and they use the table like this. So it shows us that if you roll a 1, he does 1 point of damage. If you roll a 2, he does 2 points of damage. If you roll a 3 or a 4, it doesn't do any damage. If you roll a 5 or a 6, it does 1 point of damage plus an effect. So what's an effect? Some weapons have effects like parry, in which case it's not relevant to rolling a number on the die. It just lets you parry blows. Easier. With less cost, it's more accurate, not easier. Less cost to you. However, there are other things, such as piercing, vicious. Those are the two biggest ones that we're going to talk about. They'll have a number after them, piercing 1, piercing 2, vicious 1, vicious 2, that kind of idea. So vicious 1, for every time you roll an effect, you do your first point of damage for rolling the effect, and then vicious itself also does a point of damage. So if you roll a 5, you're going to do 2 points of damage if your weapon's quality is vicious 1. If your weapon's quality is vicious 2, you're going to do 3 points of damage. 1 point for rolling the effect, 2 points for the vicious. Piercing lets you avoid armor. Works exactly the same way as we saw for vicious, only it avoids X number of points of armor. In Dungeons & Dragons, if you're wearing armor, it makes you harder to hit, harder to actually inflict damage on. In Conan, it also makes you harder to inflict damage on, but does not change how hard it is to hit you. Armor is inscribed with a thing called soak, and that takes off damage. So if my soak is 2 on my body, and you hit my body for 4 points of damage, it only does 2 points of damage. Armor has locations. Head, torso, left, right arm, left, right leg. You can use them or not, up to you. If you use them, then players will need to have weapons. So they'll have to have armor on those parts. And if they choose to armor their torso and they get hit in the head, there won't be any soak there for them. So that'll be less good for them if they get hit in the head. But you can always just say their soak over their entire body is 2. Depending on their armor. Armor has a weight, which will affect how easily they can move, be silent, how fast they can move, how far they can move, that kind of idea. While we talk about armor, we'll talk about cover. There's two kinds of soak. There's like a static soak, which is what armor has, and then there's cover, which is a rolled soak. So you might have 2 combat dice of cover, in which case you roll your 2d6s, and you roll a 1, you get 1 point of cover. You roll a 2, you get 2 points of cover. If you roll a 2 and a 5, you get 3 points of cover, etc. Same combat dice, the same values on those dice as we saw earlier. Pretty basic. So I think all that's pretty much, I mean, not completely different in D&D. It's a little bit different. You have weapons, they do damage. You have armor, which stops you from taking damage, either by subtracting damage off of you or making you harder to hit. But when we talk about initiative, it gets to be pretty different. So in D&D, roll initiative. You grab your d20, you roll, hey, I rolled a natural 20. I can't show it to you guys because the camera doesn't move, but yay, that's good. Well, I guess in Conan that's bad, but we're talking about D&D right this second, so we're going to say it's good. So, 20. Pretty good initiative. I'll probably win initiative. Awesome. So, Conan doesn't use that. Not at all. Who gets initiative in Conan? The players always get initiative in Conan. All the time. All the time. So when the encounter starts, the players get initiative. They attack first, they move first, they do all of their stuff first. There's no particular order in which they do stuff. They get the same number of actions as we talked about in the last video, a free action, a minor action, and a standard action. But when they do them, doesn't matter. That can get a little bit tricky sometimes, so have a blog post or a little video about how to ways to track that, ways to make it easier to to figure that out so the players can tell what exactly is going on, if it's their turn, if it's not their turn, that kind of idea. Can the monsters / bad guys ever go first? Yes, they can. No dice. However, we talked about Doom. When I play Doom, I have these little index cards. They have a skull on one side, a number on the other side, and then I just hang these on my screen so the players can tell that I have 1 point of Doom, or 2 points of Doom, or 4 points of Doom, or whatever. If I want to take initiative from the players, I spend a single point of Doom that allows one of the NPCs, one of the beasts, one of the bad guys to go first or interrupt wherever they are. So if we're playing, the players get initiative and we go to the very end of the round, my guy's still alive, I get to go, so he will attack. Maybe he'll do some damage, that's cool. New round starts. If I spend a point of Doom right away, that guy gets to attack again instantly. So that's one of those interesting things that Doom does. So if the players have given you a lot of Doom, or there's a lot of Doom because of whatever reason, then you can mess with the initiative a lot more. But no rolling, so interesting concept. So I've got here, apparently I'm not gonna make a video, I'm just gonna show you guys what I do. I got my characters, they've got little cards. When it's their turn, I hang the cards on my screen, like I would with the Doom things. So that's the start of the turn. When one of them finishes their move, I take their name off. Boop. When another one finishes their turn, I take their name off, etc., etc., until they're done. And I have, I don't know where it is. I have another one that I fold over, and it says GM's turn and player's turn on the other side. Then depending on whose turn it is, for the players, I typically put it out and they get to move their turn. And then when they're all done and my guys get to go, I flip it and it says GM's turn. I'm probably gonna make another one of those that say initiative interrupt, so they know that their initiative has been interrupted momentarily. If I spend a Doom point to do that. But it's an interesting concept, and it's easier for the players to see what exactly is going on. We play without it the first and half the second game, and they really had a problem knowing if it was their turn or the bad guy's turn or what was going on, because there was no your turn, your turn, your turn, your turn. It was like their turn and then my turn. And that let them see it better. And they like it a lot, so. Ah, I'm blocked. There we go. GM's turn. Player's turn. So that gets hung next to their names. I like this better than the porter I tried on episode 2. Put some more in there for me. Awesome. All right. Combat itself. How do we swing swords at each other? As we know, we don't roll initiative, and as I mentioned earlier, it's a skill test. Typically difficulty 1. If it's dark out, it might become difficulty 2. If you're in heavy brush, it might be difficulty 2 as well. If you're in heavy brush and it's dark out, might be difficulty 3. Your players will be like, I want to attack that guy. They'll go, okay, roll your d20s. So then your players will get their 2d20, and they'll tell you if they wanted to spend momentum or fortune points to get dice, or doom points to get dice, and they'll figure out how many they have. They'll get their dice out. If I get some more here, this guy's decided to roll 5d20. He made his roll, and he's got a 1, so that's 2 successes, probably. Well, in this example, we'll say his melee is 13 with a focus of 2. So, a 2. So we got a 1 and a 2. So that's 4 successes already. So 1 for rolling below his melee, 1 for rolling below his focus. So that's 4. He's got a 6, so that's 5. He's got a 7. That's 6 successes and a 14. And I think I just said his melee was 13. So that one gets burned. Doesn't actually count. So he's got 6 successes. He needed probably difficulty 1 to hit his enemy. So that is gone. That leaves this guy, after hitting him, this is 1 success, 5 momentum. That's a lot of momentum. He can use that to do extra damage. He can spend two of them to do a swift action, or swift movement, swift act, whatever it's called. There's a special name for it. And that'll let him use another standard action, or her, if it happens to be a female. And he can use that to attack again. So, pretty cool. You can only have one extra standard action per turn, so if you then generated another 5 points of momentum with the next with your next attack, you couldn't keep buying swift actions. That would be dumb. So, player hits the guy, bang, cool. And now we roll damage. So we'll look at the weapon. Maybe you'll have 5 CDs, so you'll take 5d6 and you'll roll them, figure out the damage, figure out the special effects, compare that to the armor of the guy, and apply that as damage to the bad guy until he dies. You just keep doing that. However, it's not quite that simple. There are three classes of bad guys, monsters, in Conan. We have minions. They are the weakest. Toughened guys. And we have nemesis. And as they get from minions towards nemesis, they become more and more like player characters. So a minion is the simplest. They can attack. They can do a thing called mobbing. They can't react, and they die very easily. Toughened guys are better. They can take a little bit more damage. They can react like players can, which we'll talk about in a second. And they can lead mobs to make them squads. A nemesis works just like a player character. So now that we know there's different kinds, and that some can react and some can't, we'll talk about that. So, when you get attacked, you can do things like, you can try and dodge, or you can parry, or whatever you want to try and do, basically. So if you have a weapon like a broadsword that has a parry effect and nothing else, you don't get anything from the combat dice when you roll them, but I can parry. And it makes it cheaper. So generally, every time you parry, it costs you 1 doom point for the first parry, 2 doom points for the second parry, 3 doom points for the third parry, etc., etc., etc. Those costs are reduced by 1 for having parry. So your first one's free. So that's cool. Makes not getting hit a lot easier. And when you parry, it turns the combat round into a struggle. So they'll roll their d20s, you'll roll your d20s, whoever has most momentum wins, and either deflects the blow or lands the blow. So minions can't do that, they're just fodder, they just get cut down pretty easily. But toughened guys and nemesis guys do. In D&D, it's pretty basic. You get hit and you lose hit points, you get down to 0, you die, or get to the point where you might die anyways. Conan, you have we're going to call it 4 different things, broken into physical and mental. You have stress and harm. For physical stuff, and I'm trying to do this without looking it up because I can never remember the name, so we're going to give it a shot. For physical, you have vigor and wounds. For mental, you have, these are the ones I have problems with, you have resolve and trauma. Yeah. So how do these work? Typically, players are going to have a lot more of the stress one than they're going to have of the harm one. So physical, we'll just talk about physical now because they work exactly the same. If I've got 12 points of vigor, and here, I'll just put this on the screen so you can see what I'm talking about. Whoop. So I've got 12 points of vigor and, say, 5 wounds because that's what players have. And that's what nemesis have, but not toughened guys. Toughened guys only have 2 wounds, which is why they're weaker. Here we have our chart. We have 12 points of vigor on this side, and then over here we have our 5 wounds. So when I take damage, if I roll, someone rolls 5 CD and they do 5 points of damage, and I have 2 soak, I'm going to take 3 points of damage. How does that work? It means my vigor goes down by 3. There. So I'm taking 3 points of vigor damage. If my vigor is reduced all the way to 0, I take a wound. If I take a wound, difficulty goes up by 1. If I take 2 wounds, difficulty goes up by 2. So basically, as you take wounds, things start to go south pretty fast. So you move down to 0 vigor. Now your difficulty, well, if you got removed, if you got hit, and all your vigor went down to zero, you're going to take a wound automatically. And if another guy hits you, you're going to take another wound. So now you're going to be down to normal difficulty threes to attack. So that's pretty bad. Now, that being said, if you have 12 points of vigor, so you walk in and you've got all your vigor, 12 points of vigor, and a grizzly bear attacks you and swipes his massive claws at your head, and he hits you in the helmet, which has, say, a soak of 2, but he does 8 points of damage. So he's still going to have done 6 points of vigor to you. So what happens? Do I just take 6 points of vigor off? Well, yes, you do take 6 points of vigor off, but because that attack did more than 5 wounds, or 5 vigors, not wounds, did 5 points of vigor or more in an attack, you also take a wound. So now you're going to have, your vigor is going to be reduced by half, and you're going to take a wound because it was such a massive attack. So wounds show us actual physical damage to a player, and vigor shows us incidental scratches, fatigue, that kind of thing. So when you're done your action scene, and this is sort of up to the GM, if there's a lot of time in between action scenes, then their vigor gets restored automatically. They don't need healing potions, they don't need anything. Just, they're rested, good enough. If they're in a tomb, and they're only in there for like a half hour, half a day or something like that, then you might not want to give them all back, or you might want to give some of them back. I'll leave that up to you, as a GM, how you want to play it. Wounds need skills to heal. Generally, you will heal the wound. So if I have taken 2 points of wounds, and my difficulty is 3, if someone has a healing skill, they can heal those wounds and take them away, sort of. So again, up to you as GM, how long you want to give them to actually heal those wounds. But it's not right away. So if I take a wound in combat, or 2 wounds in combat, like I was saying, and I get healed, I'm healed, my difficulty is now back to 1, awesome. If I take another wound before everything is healed up, like in the same day or the same month or whatever, I don't just take 1 wound, I take the new wound and the other 2 wounds open back up. So now I have 3 wounds, so not good. Mentor works exactly the same way, only there's a council skill, so you can kind of tell them and convince them that it didn't really happen, it wasn't that bad, no big deal, blah, blah, blah. There's also, now I'm kind of rambling a little bit about different kinds of attacks. So you have your physical attacks, and you have mental attacks as well, so you can, like, try and scare away bad guys with your battle prowess. But I want to go back to minions. I want to talk about mobs. Because why are they... So mobs can be either organized or minions. Minions can be organized either as individuals or as mobs. If they're mobs, they can have up to 5 guys in a mob. Boop, 5 guys. They will... Oh, there's another big difference between mobs and minions. Between minions and toughened and nemesis. Minions only roll 1d20 each. So when they're organized into mobs, they roll 1d20 for each guy in the mob. So they roll 5d20 for their attack roll. They only roll 1 damage roll though. So, good chance they'll hit. Good chance the player might be able to parry. It's only 1 parry. And damage won't be that bad. And armor is only... So if they have a soak of 2 in that mob, and they have, say, 5 points of vigor and 1 wound, it's a good numbers to use. And your barbarian guy, whatever he happens to be, rolls in and rolls, I don't know, 9 points of damage. When he rolls that 9 points of damage, he's going to do enough damage to kill the first guy, and then the rest of that damage, the next 4 points, are going to carry over to the next guy. So one guy's going to die, one guy's going to get grievously wounded. If he does 10 points of damage, he's actually going to kill 2 guys outright, provided they didn't have any armor. If the minions have, or in a mob, and they have 2 soak, and he does 12 points of damage, when he hits that mob, the soak's going to take off the first 2, leaving 10 points of damage to apply to the mob, and again, he's going to kill 2 guys. So they're a little bit, they can get killed pretty easily that way. If you split them up, they are a lot less likely to hit guys. They roll 1d20, and they have to rely on doom. to generate enough dice to be successful in their attacks and not be parried. If you use toughened guys to lead the minions, it's handy to have your four dice, because you only have five guys in a squad or mob. It's good to have four black dice, and then a couple of other d20s to roll for the toughened guy, because they're going to have a higher success. So probably, and they roll 2d20. So again, minions organized into mobs. Soaks applied once. Damage is carried over to the mob. You can't attack the toughened guy if he's leading, unless you use a called shot, which is momentum. Generally, you'll attack the squad and you'll kill guys one at a time, so you get to the leader. He's a toughened guy. He has two wounds, so he takes a little bit longer to kill. The nemesis has whatever. He's going to have five wounds, and his vigor is going to be just like a player's. And those guys are all going to have special abilities based on what they are. They're probably going to have doom spins, so special doom spins that each guy can use. Earlier in the video, I talked about reach. I said reach wasn't how long a weapon can strike. It was a measure of how two weapons can interact with each other. So we'll talk about that now, because it's a fairly interesting part of combat that I really think is cool, based on my own personal experiences doing SCA combat. So, reach and guard. Guard is a state by which characters are ready for combat, and they have their stance and they're ready to go. And that guard can be broken by momentum spends. But in our first example, we will have a spearman, and we will have a swordsman on this side. So if the swordsman is attacking the spearman is the defender, then we see that the defender has guard. He does have guard. Then the difficulty of the attacker increases by one step for every point of difference in their reach. So spearman's defending, it's harder for the attacker to actually get past the point of the spear and attack the spearman. So they have a difference in this case of reach 3 for the spearman, reach 2 for the swordsman. Difference of 1 means that the attack for the swordsman on the spearman is actually difficulty 2. If it's dark out, then it'll be difficulty 2 plus 1 will be difficulty 3. So that's how that works. However, if the swordsman succeeds, generates some momentum, and breaks the guard of the spearman, he will get past the spearman's point. The spearman will not currently be ready as he was before, and now we will compare their reaches when he attacks, and the swordsman will gain a d20 for every point of reach different than the defender. So now we have a spearman who has reach 3, a swordsman has broken his guard, got past. His difficulty is not going to be more extreme now because he doesn't have guard. Difficulty 1 again. And now he's going to get an extra die because he's past that spear point. So I think that's a pretty interesting concept. And as I said, fighting in the SCA for, I don't know, 20 years, that mirrors my experience with fighting spears and longer weapons. So earlier in this video, I had promised you guys a complete sample of a combat round or a duel to the death between two guys. Apparently I'm incapable of making short videos because this is already over half an hour, I believe. So we're going to cut and move that to another video, which is strictly that combat round. And I probably won't have that up right away, but hopefully this week coming up, I'll get that up and we'll put a link below to that video. So we'll talk quickly about ranges. I don't remember if we talked about this in video 2. I'm not sure that we did. So we'll talk about it now anyways. Range, how does range work? D&D, again the example, squares, 5 foot per square, guy can move 30 feet, moves 6 squares. So Conan doesn't use squares, he uses zones. Zones are areas where action occurs, typically centered around a piece of terrain. So if we look at my really quick map here, we will see we have like a really basic town square, and then in the middle we have a fountain, and the north side of that we have a gate To the east of that, we have a market stall. The west, we have like a building door. And south, we have the entrance into the town square. So combat in this zone might occur by the gate, by the fountain, by the marshal, by the merchanting stall, by the storefront, or by the entrance into the square. If we want, you could draw zone lines around all these things so you have an idea if you really want to. It's not really necessary. So you have my zones on here that we just talked about. As you can see on the map, numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Action could happen in any one of these zones. They still have ranges though. So you can be in the same zone and not touching. If you're there, you're considered to be short range, which means you can throw short range weapons at each other. You can't attack in melee. There's touching, which is the same zone, only touching. So if we're in that square and touching each other, we can enter into melee combat. If we're in medium range, that is the next zone over. If we're in long range, that's two zones over. I'm not sure if there's an extreme range or not, I can't remember. If there is, it'll be longer than that. So each weapon is going to use, have its own optimal range, which some people like, some people don't. Some of them are kind of weird, but again, one of the things that I wanted to throw in at the beginning, I totally forgot, is what we're trying to accomplish with this combat system. What are we trying to accomplish with this combat system? We're trying to accomplish realistic medieval combat? No, we're not. Really, we're not. We're not. We're trying to create action scenes that replicate the feel of Conan's pulp adventures, which, as you can imagine, aren't always the most realistic combat scenes in the world, but they're cool, and that's what's important. Okay, so now we've talked about range. I want to just throw in one other little interesting thing about ranged weapons. Things like axes that you can throw. If you throw an axe, you're going to have to go collect it, because you have one axe. It's not a missile weapon. If you have a bow and arrow, it's generally assumed you have enough arrows that will be recoverable and you won't need to really track. But that being said, you do have things called loads. So you might have 1, 2, 3, or 4 loads. So if I have 4 loads and I'm shooting arrows one at a time, I don't need to track those at all. I don't need to recover them. If I'm using a special ability called volley, which lets you shoot more arrows, shooting a volley takes a load. So if I shoot a lot of arrows in a single blow, a single shot, I need to recover that load like I'd recover that axe. So I might lose it, I might not. Throwing knives, again, work like arrows. So you might have loads of them, or you might have throwing them one at a time, in which case you don't need to track it. So that makes it a little bit simpler if you're just shooting one at a time. You don't have to track that I have 10 arrows or 12 arrows, no one cares. Just shoot your arrows normally, unless you're shooting them with special abilities. That's really pretty much all I have to say about combat. It feels kind of rambly, and there's a lot to take in, and it really feels complicated and slow and clunky. But again, I'm here to tell you, which you will see in episode 4, that it's not. It runs really smoothly, it's really easy, to get your head around. It's simple. It's fast, it's fun. Trust me. Come back for episode 4, and I'll show you. If you really want to make sure you see episode 4, please hit that subscribe button down below, right here by Conan. Click on Conan. He will let you subscribe, okay? If you like it, click like. If you like this video, click like. And that's all I have for today. So remember, subscribe, click on Conan, or like me. Yeah, that's right, everyone. Please like me. Please. No, I don't care. Like me or not, don't care. Leave comments below, and we will continue this in episode 4. Thanks for watching. Cheers.